Good morning, Eisenhower. I'm Natalie.
And I'm Cooper.
Good morning, Mr. Gottheimer, and welcome to ETV.
Morning. Thanks for having me.
ETV invited congressional candidates Mr. Garrett and Mr. Gottheimer to appear on ETV. Today, we have the privilege to sit down with District 5 congressional candidate Josh Gottheimer.
Mr. Gottheimer began working in politics at a young age and was previously employed in the White House under President Bill Clinton. Thank you for meeting with us today, Mr. Gottheimer.
It's great to be here. Thanks for having me.
Why did you decide to run for Congress?
Well, I think like most people, I'm a bit frustrated with how things are in Washington and in politics, and people seem to want to scream at each other more than actually get things done and insult each other, and I really want to actually sit down at tables with Democrats, Republicans, and independents, and actually try to get some things done again. I was in the private sector. I was most recently at Microsoft working, and I just hit the wall. No more of this. I just frustrated like most people about what's going on. So I thought that we could do better here. Our families deserve better. I want to do more for you and for the future. And so I decided to run. And so far, so good.
My questions are about jobs in the United States. Your website says that if elected, jobs will be one of your main focuses. So what is your view on the U.S. economy regarding jobs?
Well, I think, you know, I'm really focused especially on New Jersey and where we live, which is the 5th District. And right now in the state of New Jersey, the job situation is not as good as it should be. The economic growth isn't where it should be. And I talk a lot about taxes, and that's one of the big reasons I think that actually things are being held back in the state. People, both for property taxes that they pay and then federal taxes they pay, it's just too high. My biggest thing that I'm focused on is tax reform to figure out how we can actually get the taxes down. And also with what we are paying, because we pay too much, and what we are paying, actually getting more back to New Jersey, into the 5th District. You know, we send a lot of money to the federal government. We're one of the biggest taxpayers in the country to the federal government, yet we're at the bottom in terms of how much we get back for our roads, for our schools, for our fixing bridges, for clean drinking water. And I think we shouldn't be at the bottom given how much we pay. We should be much higher up in the ladder. And so that's what I'm going to really focus on.
And how will you discourage companies from moving their business overseas?
Well, I think there's two problems, and it's a great question. There's one is businesses moving overseas, which actually I think fixing the tax code, which is what I just talked about, could help making that less of an incentive for companies to actually move away. But two, it's actually how do you keep businesses here in the 5th District and in New Jersey and keep them from moving away, and then how do you get more businesses to move here? You know, we have so much going for us. Obviously great schools with great teachers. We have beautiful parks, beautiful areas. We've got great pizza. We've got Bruce Springsteen. We've got a lot of things going for us, but yet I think we're really not making the case to companies why they should be here. We've lost big businesses like Hertz and Mercedes, two big companies in the last couple of years. A&P, the grocery store chain, just went out of business. And then there's all those jobs that go with it, the restaurants and the dry cleaners and all the stores around here. And if you want to fix an economy, you've got to make it, you've got to really keep, it all comes down to jobs, as you point out. So we have to start by actually keeping the companies here. My job as a member of Congress is actually to get things more affordable so that they can be here and want to be here and that people want to stay here and move here, but then B, go around and actually show companies how much we have going for us and that they should come here and be a champion for us. And I think that's a huge part of my job, and I plan to make it one.
And how do you plan to bring more jobs to District 5, like you said earlier?
Well, I think as part of that, I think, which is an excellent question you asked, is I actually believe that I should be out there meeting with companies and saying, here's all we have going for us. For instance, we have the second fastest broadband, internet infrastructure underground in the entire country here in Northern Jersey. The whole back office, the whole back end of the New York Stock Exchange is in Mahwah, New Jersey, which is right near here, and it's in our district. But yet we don't do a good job of actually selling to other tech companies to come here, and I think, if given what we have going for us, they should be here. And that's part of what I think we need to make an argument for. We've always had a great history in the pharmaceutical industry and life sciences, and we seem to have let a lot of those companies go. Why aren't we doing more to try to bring them here? And if we're thinking about, I want you to want to, not when you go off to college, to actually come back here and move back here. You know, I went off to school and then I moved back to, I'm raising my family and my 4-year-old and my 7-year-old. And I'm doing it because it's a great place to live. But I realize how expensive it is, and the question is, can we make it more affordable, and can we show people why it's so great to live here and raise a family here? And that's what I'm focused on.
And what's your opinion on the minimum wage?
Well, I think we should raise the minimum wage. Right now, I think we should nationally focus on raising it to $12, and other states should have the flexibility to raise it higher. But you know, I think if you tried living here in New Jersey in the northern part of the state on $12 an hour, it'd be tough, and certainly $8 an hour. So I think we should raise it higher, and I think that would give people more money to spend, hopefully in the stores and businesses here. But overall, I think the idea on the economy is if we have more jobs coming here, if we have more jobs staying here, there'll be better paying jobs for everybody. And that starts with actually getting our taxes under control and less regulation. Less of the, there's too many of these unnecessary, outdated rules in place that are actually holding back businesses and companies, small and big, from wanting to be here. And I think that we have to deal with this if we want to get our economy moving.
And what do you think are necessities for every employee with regards to paid maternity or sick leave?
I believe that if somebody is going to have a child, or somebody has a sick loved one, a parent or a child, it would break my heart if a business said you can't work here anymore because you got to go take care of your parent or take care of your child. So I believe we need to have sick leave, and I understand. Listen, you've got to make sure that these things are all balanced out for businesses. But I've never found anybody. My dad ran a small business his whole life, and growing up, we lived about 20 minutes from here in North Caldwell, and he never would, if somebody was sick, would never not let them come back to work. And I think most people I've talked to who own businesses and have worked in companies feel the same way. It's just the right thing you do, and I think we need to treat each other with respect.
I would now like to talk about national security and terrorism. Do you believe that the government...
That's a big transition.
Okay, go on. Do you believe that the government should focus more on U.S.'s security?
On what? I'm sorry?
On the U.S.'s security.
Yeah, it's one of the... I've put out two big plans on what we need to do to make sure we keep our country safe. When you take an oath of office, when I get sworn in to be in Congress, you take the same oath the president takes, and it's the... defend the country from all threats, domestic and foreign. And I think if that's the number one thing anyone who serves has to focus on, is protecting us from all threats. And I think unfortunately right now there's a lot going on in the world. Overseas, ISIS and terror continues to be a major threat. There's a lot of instability around the world. But also here at home, we've seen with too many of these attacks, lone wolf terrorist attacks in our communities, that we need to make sure we're doing everything humanly possible to prevent them, to stop them. We need to make sure our law enforcement, our local law enforcement, has the tools they need to actually respond and to deal with them. We need to make sure our intelligence operations have what they need. I'm very hawkish in this area. That's why you stand by veterans after they serve, so that we get the best people to serve. And of course, we need to make sure that our military and all of our intelligence apparatus have all the tools they need to fight all threats.
In your opinion, what is currently the number one security problem in the United States that puts civilians in danger of possible terrorism?
Well, I think we have seen, it's a somber question, and I think we've seen way too many incidents in our country in the last couple of years. From lone wolf terrorists, from people who don't love the country the way they should. They're here and they're not here for the right reasons, and I think we must make sure we root out the initial problem. A lot of this is happening online. You can go to YouTube now and find out how to build a bomb, or people and from ISIS are putting propaganda online and trying to turn people against the United States of America. I think we have to be very aggressive in stopping that. I also believe we have to make sure that our communities have, as I said a minute ago, the tools they need to fight lone wolf terror before it spreads. And also, there are plenty of, there are other homegrown militia groups that we also have to keep an eye on that want to overthrow our government. And we see, unfortunately, with what's going on in the presidential race, there's a lot of people coming out with a lot of nastiness and hate toward our government. And I don't have patience for that. We live in the greatest country in the world. Our job is to protect it and make sure we stand up to all threats.
If elected, how are you planning to address the security problems that exist currently and could possibly put citizens not only locally but nationally in danger of terrorism?
Well, that's a similar question, and I think my answer is similar in that we have to be you have to be vigilant. You know, we all have, as citizens, we all have a responsibility to keep our eyes open. You know, they say you're going to watch out what you're, you know, always keep your eyes open, watch out. And if you see a package, call. If you see something suspicious, call. And that's why, you know, I'm a very big supporter of law enforcement. I have the support of the state law enforcement associations, you know, and the local law enforcement and the firefighters. You know, these people are, who serve us and protect us and put their lives on their line every day, are heroes. And, you know, whether they go overseas, those who, the veterans who go overseas, come back and are veterans and they go overseas and serve on the front lines, they're heroes. Our job is to make sure that they're protected and that we stand by them and get their back, so they, because they get our backs every day. And to me, making sure they have the tools to fight lone wolf terror is critical. To make sure that we don't let terrorists on the FBI watch lists, which you've probably heard of on terrorists on watch lists, are able to buy guns, like assault rifles. I think that that's a huge mistake, right? If you're a terrorist on an FBI watch list or a terror watch list, you shouldn't be able to buy a weapon, an assault rifle. And I feel strongly about that. And I don't see anybody, I don't understand anybody who wouldn't do everything humanly possible to stop terror.
Okay, so Muslims are being treated like all different ways now. So how should we treat Muslims in the U.S. and abroad?
Listen, I think we treat, our country is a wonderful patchwork of people from all different backgrounds. And, you know, at the end, and what I believe fundamentally is that our differences are, as a country, are our greatest strengths. We are, you know, aside from Native Americans who are here, we're all immigrants. We've all come from different places, and it's what makes our country as beautiful as it is, and also as strong as it is in terms of our economic strength and our diversity. The fact that people would not treat everybody with similar respect, to me is really, frankly, depressing. You know, and it is, and you know, I don't care who you are, we treat everyone the same. Your religious backgrounds, your beliefs. What you look like, your backgrounds, it shouldn't matter. What should matter, of course, is that we protect our country, and if somebody is a threat, no matter who they are or where they're from, that we should deal with it. We obviously, if people are immigrating into America, we should make sure that everybody passes background checks and that we do everything possible to make sure that people are here, want to be here. But that doesn't mean you pick any group out. You treat everybody with respect.
So we're going to make another giant switch of topics.
Okay.
How do you think kids my age should be involved in politics?
Well, I think what you're doing now is great, because obviously you know a lot, so that's good. You all are doing a terrific job. So I was really lucky. I got interested in I used to read the paper with my dad every day, and I got interested in policy and public service really young. I was, I think, 16 the first time I went to Washington and got an internship working for Senator Frank Lautenberg, who was our U.S. one of our U.S. senators at the time. And I distinctly remember answering a phone call in his office with a senior citizen who couldn't get their Social Security. Something had happened and she wasn't able to afford her medicine. And we fixed it. You know, we got on the phone, I called the Social Security office, and I was 16, and we fixed this problem. So my point to you is, at any age, you can do anything if you get involved. And what I hope, and part of the reason I'm running, is that I want a stronger future for our kids and our grandkids and for my 4-year-old and 7-year-old, and I want them to appreciate and want to be part of serving, and know that the government is, you know, right now we just have this, I don't blame people, you watch TV and you watch what's going on, and you can't but help at your age see, well, what's wrong? Why can't these people actually get anything done? What's the nastiness about? And I fundamentally believe we live in the greatest country in the world, so things should be better, and we should look up to people and look up to everyone who serves, and I want everybody to get that at a young age so that they will want to actually serve in public versus looking down upon our institutions. And so, to me, you can get involved. The fact that you're involved right now and getting involved in the issues is the great first step. Next, after I get elected, you come intern for me, and then, you know, we'll keep you along and hopefully you stay involved.
Similar about getting involved in politics, we see a lot of lawn signs promoting you and other candidates. Besides getting lawn signs out, what else do you and your voters do to promote your campaign when you are running for Congress?
It's a good question. Well, you know, people have been so great of all ages and to our campaign, and I'm very, very lucky. You know, if someone comes up to you and wants to help you, you might imagine it's a great thing because they want to be part of it. And politics and government is a team sport. right? I mean, it's really everybody, it's about everybody getting involved. And we've got, so putting up a lawn sign is one way people get involved, right? They say, I'm with Josh, and that's great, and then hopefully their friends see it, so that's one way. We've got an office in our headquarters in Paramus. We've got lots of people who come, like hundreds of people every week, who come and volunteer, and they make phone calls, and they put together signs. They go knock on doors and say, you know, here's why you should support one candidate, you know, support us. And that there's so many ways to get involved. I have people who work on policy with us and talk about the issues and get involved in the issues like you all are doing. And so there's so many ways to get involved. Other people make a contribution, of course, and give us a few dollars to help the campaign. So there's many different ways. But the key is getting people involved and seeing that there are differences between me and my opponent, like the very clear differences. And to me, the most important thing is people understanding what they're voting for, you know, what I believe in, right, and what my opponent believes in, because elections are about choices, right? They're just choices between two different perspectives, and the choice in this election here in the 5th Congressional District couldn't be clearer. We have big differences, you know, and the question is, which side do you want to go for? You know, I think we need to get back to better values, and I call them Jersey values, and I believe in lower taxes, and I think we stand by our first responders and our veterans and law enforcement, and that we treat women with respect and families with respect. And, you know, we make sure we stand by people, you know, and I'll leave it to you to talk about the other side. But the other side is a very different point of view than me. And you know, I believe the government has a focused but limited role. And you know, my opponent and I have very, very different perspectives on things. And I think you're hearing I'm much more of a kind of a middle of the road person. I believe there's great ideas on both sides. I want to work with both sides, Democrats, Republicans, and independents. You know, and my opponent admittedly is far off to one side, and that's a difference, and I think people should just understand that.
Okay, as a candidate to represent New Jersey's 5th District in the House of Representatives, which issues do you regard as pressing, and how would you address them?
I'm glad you asked. Well, as I've talked about a few times, comprehensive tax reform, figuring out ways to actually lower our taxes. Secondly, eliminating what I call the Garrett tax, which is the fact that we are paying so much in federal taxes and getting back so little for it. So I want to lower taxes, but I also think instead of getting 33 cents back for every dollar we pay in federal taxes now, when the state average is 68 cents, and West Virginia gets $4.23 for every dollar they pay in things back like fixing our roads and bridges. And like, I actually think we, you know, should do more to get a lot more back for what we're paying and a better return on our investment. And so that's sort of my tax issue. I believe deeply in investing in fixing infrastructure, our roads, our bridges. You can't have a healthy economy if it takes people an hour and 45 minutes to drive from Wyckoff to New York City in the morning. When the trains have unfortunate accidents, or we have the second worst on-time statistics in the entire country on New Jersey Transit. It's at the bottom. That shouldn't be in a great economy like ours. And third, I'm really focused on STEM education, the sciences, the maths, engineering, because you know, I studied history, and I think people need to, that writing and reading is critical. We also need to make sure that people have the skills in the sciences and math where a lot of the jobs of the future are going to be. And I learned this in Microsoft. If we have all these jobs available for kids coming out of college in computer programming and engineering, and yet we don't have enough people who have those skills. And so I want to get more people excited at a young age, at your age, about those areas, right? Robotics and programming. And if we do get people excited, and we have incredible facilities at our schools here in Wyckoff and in the state, we get people excited, you know, it's another great avenue for jobs and opportunity in the future, and good for our economy in New Jersey.
So which committees would you like to serve on in the House, and would you please explain why?
Sure. So I'd like to be on the Financial Services Committee, which is, you know, things related to banks and the economic undergirding of our whole economy, which, by the way, as you know, so many people who work here and live here are involved in the financial industry. It is the economic engine of our country and the world. And when New York City is only a few miles away, where is ground, it's like sort of the base of all of that activity. And so I think that's a very, very important committee for our economy and something I'm very interested in. I'd also like to serve on the Intelligence Committee, which, as you know, we were just talking about a lot of issues that I think are so critical that the Intelligence Committee focuses on. I would also be interested in, because you don't get to pick, you don't necessarily get your first pick, transportation infrastructure, just because I talked a lot about it as you hear. I think that's very, very important to our economy in New Jersey. And so those are all areas that I'm interested in.
Okay, so the last question. What is your overall vision for the United States at the moment in our nation's history?
That's a big question. My overall vision, which I hope has come through this interview, is that I believe if we focus on the future versus looking backward, that if we realize that our best days are ahead of us, which it's the only way I wake up every day and do this job, is that you have to believe, I think, that our best days are ahead of us as a country, and that it's all about you. I mean, which is why I'm here this morning, because I believe that at the end of the day, my job is to make sure we build a better future for you, and that we have everything we need as a country, and as a state, and as a district, to be able to give you the tools you need in your lives to be successful. And that's obviously about education, that's obviously about making sure we have a safe community, and a beautiful community, that we have a clean environment, that we have good roads, all those things, we make it affordable for people so they can be here. To me, all those things are part of the package that we're supposed to be delivering to the next generation. And that's what I'm fighting for. It's why I decided to do this. And I really think we live in the greatest country in the world. And in my heart, I know that. And that's why I believe our best days are ahead of us.
Okay. Thank you for being our guest today.
Thank you both. You did a great job. Thank you so much for having me. Thanks. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you.